flesh is real food and my blood is real drink. By eating my flesh and drinking my blood, you enter into me and I into you. In the same way that the fully alive Father sent me here, and I live because of him, so the one who makes a meal with me lives because of me. This is the bread from heaven. Your ancestors ate bread and later died. Whoever eats this bread will live always. Well, today's gospel, you might have noticed, sounds similar to the readings from the past few weeks. All of the prior lessons in today's lesson from John speak about the bread of life. We've heard it repeatedly. Marketing research tells us that people need to hear something 7 times to remember it. Jesus' repetition in John, even though it was prior to modern-day marketing research, is important to know. Jesus repeats himself maybe so that he can be sure that his listeners are really hearing his message. His message here is that important. In this passage, Jesus says he is the bread of life and adds that his blood and flesh will give the world everlasting life. The world is invited to eat and drink of him for everlasting life. Now, the Jewish leaders could not begin to grasp what Jesus was getting at by making such claims. And in verse 52, I just read this. They said, at this, the Jews started fighting among themselves. How can this man store up his flesh for a meal? And then Jesus says, only insofar as you eat and drink flesh and blood, the flesh and blood of the Son of Man, do you have life within you? These leaders, who were known for being antagonists for Jesus, here eat flesh and drink blood, and all of their sensitivities about purity and righteousness were overwhelmed. Consuming blood, even of animals, was not accepted within the Jewish practices. So Jesus saying that they should drink his blood was quite disturbing. The eating of flesh compounded their concerns. Now, the Greek word used in the later part of this passage for eating is better translated as devouring or gnawing. So gnawing on the flesh. That language even makes me a bit uncomfortable thinking about its literal interpretation. The Jewish authorities only heard the literal. They weren't able to understand what Jesus was getting at. Jesus was pointing to his divinity as the incarnate God. But they couldn't see it then. And even now, it's hard for us to understand. Jesus' humanity is emphasized in this chapter of John as flesh and blood because Jesus was flesh and blood. It seems that Jesus was more concerned with getting people to trust and participate with him than he was getting them to completely understand him. In this confusing yet meaningful text, he was offering a way for us to personally and openly participate with God. Up until Jesus' time, the world's relationship with God had known some rough times. We know from the Old Testament there was time after time when God entered into a covenant with her people, but her people lost trust and turned to other gods. So then, God sent Jesus to renew the relationship with the world through a new covenant. The covenant of the Messiah holds the promise for full and eternal life for all people in participation with God. That was what Jesus was talking about. Full and eternal life. Life now with God, and life eternal with God. This Jesus of flesh and blood was the physical participation that God was providing to his people and to us. A physical, tangible relationship with God through Christ. In our humanness, we struggle with trusting what we can't fully explain we want to know that this eternal life Jesus speaks of is truly for us. We want to understand heaven and hell. We want to. But the truth is that we cannot even completely understand the death on the cross and the resurrection. How do we begin to think we can understand the rest of it? We can only trust it. It's our faith that keeps us in this relationship with God. Our faith helps us to put aside our need to know. So what did you come in for today? Did you come in for church, the great music, the sacrament, the community, the word? Did you come in for peace, hope, comfort, love, maybe forgiveness? What about for shelter from a personal storm or answers to why things happen? Did you come in for a quiet place to calm your mind and refuel your soul? Or maybe you came in with hopes to feel something of the presence of God. I want to share with you the part of the first lesson from this week's lectionary. It's from the book of Proverbs. And it reads, "Are you confused about life? Don't know what's going on? Come with me. Oh, come with me and have dinner with me. I've prepared a wonderful spread. Fresh baked bread, roast lamb, carefully selected wines. Leave your impoverished confusion and live. Walk up the street to a life with meaning." Life with meaning. The life that Christ offers to us is a life of meaning, a life of living and loving here and now because of all that the living bread offers to us. But how is it that we consume the living bread? How do we take in Christ? Of course, by participating in Holy Communion. And in a few minutes, we will share the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. This is a physical participation with Christ through bread and wine, which for Lutherans holds the promise of Christ coming to us by being present in, with, and under the elements. In common elements, bread and wine, God participates with us. God becomes a partner in our daily joys and sorrows, our challenges and our accomplishments. God, through Christ's sacrifice, is within us as the elements. We share in God, and God shares in us. We also take in Christ when we study the scriptures. The word is God's message of love for all people. And we need to study it to feed our faith. We take Christ into ourselves when we love, selflessly love one another. We take Christ into ourselves when we serve others in need. As Jesus said, he is true food and true drink. There are things that we can feed on that promise a full life, even a great life, like power or wealth. But a life in relationship with God grants us the blessings of those things that we need the most. Love, forgiveness, commitment, and grace. These are blessings that are not just reserved for Lutherans and not just reserved for Christians. As Jesus said, this life of grace is for the whole world. No one is unwelcome to come to him. No one is too different, broken, sad, or sinful for God. It's a message that the world needs to hear. Although I don't know what you came in for today, my hope is that you leave here feeling welcomed to this community, knowing how loved you are by our God, and that you are filled with the true bread of life, which will sustain and accompany you every day of your life. Amen. Let's pray together. Holy God, at times when our faith is challenged, our questions mount, and our lives seem unbearable, may we remember that you are with us life in us may we make each day a